I hate that one. They don't know it won't hurt them. Oh, it's alive.
I like going out there.
Yeah. Okay.
Then, when I think of the implications.
Hi, everyone. I'm Eric Engleman. I'm the technology editor at Politico, and we're here to discuss cybersecurity under Trump, which is a topic of high interest for all of us. I want to start by introducing our panelists. I'll go from my left and go down the line here. First, we have Austin Carson. He's legislative director for Congressman Michael McCaul. Jim Lewis is senior vice president and director of the Strategic Technologies Program at the Center for Strategic and International Studies. Bruce Mehlman is former Assistant Secretary of Commerce for Technology Policy, and he's Executive Director for the Technology CEO Council. And last, we have Shane Tews. She's Vice Chair of the Internet Education Foundation. So let's get underway. I want to start with the biggest story in cybersecurity right now, which is Russian hacking and the election. And just throw it out there for these guys. We've seen President Trump acknowledge that Russia was responsible for the hacking of the Democratic Party, but said the leaks had nothing to do with his election victory. I want to ask the panelists, how do you see this playing out in the weeks and months ahead, including with the Russia hacking sanctions that were imposed by former President Obama? Jim, do you want to start with that one?
Not really, but I'm from the Specky. So it was like we had a discussion in the green room about who would be the sacrificial victim, and I did not volunteer. So, I think the president is right that the Russian hacking did not affect the outcome of the election. So that seems to be the consensus, I think, of a lot of people in the field who do this. But at the same time, I think most people would agree that it was also unacceptable, right? And so there's clear evidence of Russian government involvement with two intelligence agencies, the FSB and the GRU. And so the question is, what do we do back? And the issue is important not because our election is over, and the Russians might take credit. I'm sure they're patting themselves on the back or drinking vodka, which is what they usually do. The issue is they're also targeting the elections in Germany, France, the UK, and I believe the Netherlands. So we have a problem here. One of the issues we have for cybersecurity is we've been worrying about, depending on which epoch it was, cyber Pearl Harbors, or more recently, cyber 9/11s. And we got it wrong in targeting the threat. What the Russians did is the face of cyber war. And so how do we respond?
Mm-hmm. Bruce?
Joining Jim in the pool, what the Russians clearly seem to have done is definitely bad and needs to be understood and a proper response considered. I'm not positive it's a cyber issue per se, because in the end, disinformation campaigns, efforts to influence other countries' elections are really important, but they're foreign policy. And the only cyber aspect where purloined information were obtained through hacking, and it was released on the internet. But multi-factor authentication here would have probably stopped the acquisition of the information. So I think there are a whole lot of really critical cyber issues and nation-state cyber issues. The election angle itself feels to me much more of a foreign relations committee type issue than a cyber subcommittee issue.
Mm-hmm. Shane or Austin?
Yeah, and I'll tack on to that to say, it's obviously complicated with a lot of the diplomatic reset envisioned by the incoming administration, to put it as diplomatically and lightly as possible. But to Bruce's point, it is important to recognize that unlike a different type of hypothetical cyber event where perhaps some foreign actor could make a kinetic attack or could, something of that nature, this speaks more to Russia's concept of psychological warfare, and also speaks to the fact that we still have very tenuous international cyber norms to any extent. There's not really any known rules of the road in terms of purloining information, in terms of, you know, what you do in digital space versus physical space. And until we have something to that extent, we're never going to be able to effectively combat these types of actions.
I'm going to go a little more parochial. I always like to remind people that the Russians didn't write the emails. Because that, I mean, so what's interesting is it reminds us all that, you know, all that information that is on, you know, all these different data systems need to be protected. And this was just a case of not taking that responsibility as seriously. I think two-factor authentication could have been a really easy, you know, way to manage that. But again, to Bruce's point and to Jim's is, you know, we're looking at an asymmetrical response to, you know, what has been done here. And the question of, you know, whether or not, I don't think it changed the outcome to the election, but I think it certainly put the idea of, you know, managing cyber going forward as a trust issue. We need to, you know, the internet is built oddly on trust. And you talk to engineers and you say, well, why does it work this way? And it's like, well, it's the way we configured it. And it continues to work that way. And that's great. But as we look at the next generation, we have to look at how we're going to be managing information flow going forward and protecting it from, you know, both from an offensive and a defensive perspective.
I wanted to go back to something that Jim mentioned in his answer, which was a couple years ago, all the talk when we talked about cybersecurity was about protecting critical infrastructure like the electrical grid. That's gotten overshadowed more recently by the Russia situation, but do the panelists believe that that issue will come back as a cybersecurity issue? And I guess a related question would be, should our electoral system be considered critical infrastructure? Anybody want to pick up on that?
Well, I think going to the electrical grid, one of the things that reminds you is, you know, like, I mean, there are a lot of my friends who've done exercises have always said that you need to make sure that your gas tank's never less than 50%, as, you know, and especially when you live in Washington. I've gone to the point where, like, if my phone gets below 70, I sort of freak out. I mean, just, like, I plug in, as you can tell, my phone's plugged in over there, you know, all the time, because once the electricity goes out, almost like my entire world ends. I mean, I'll be down to daylight to be able to do something. So I think that it is really challenging because the utilities in our, you know, our energy grid is running so much of what we do as individuals and our digital infrastructure that allows us to have this very robust, you know, economy that we'd all like to be living in. So it's a huge issue, and making sure that it's protected at the right level and understanding where that is. And then we have the challenge of all the different silos of how we manage, you know, the information flow and the information security and sharing to make sure that anything that they learn in that system, we hopefully will learn from a schematic, so it doesn't happen if it happens in the SCADA system somewhere else, that we can keep that from happening.
Jim, can you expand on your thoughts? I mean, is it did people get it wrong? Was it really about information warfare?
So you have to get a little more precise on, Jimi Hendrix. There's a blast from the past, right? you have to get a little more specific on people's doctrine for using cyber attack, and it's not all the same as ours. We tend to focus on military and kinetic effect, interfering with opponent forces. The other guys are different, and so when you look at the Russians, number one on the hit parade for them is this kind of political manipulation, psychological warfare that we were talking about. And it's right in their military doctrine. It says you want to do pre-conflict opinion shaping. That does not mean, oh, you can't hear me back there? Now we're really going to get feedback. That does not mean they're not interested in exploring attacks on infrastructure. So they did the Ukrainian power facility. They probably did the German steel mill. And there's been one other incident where Russian government entities attacked critical infrastructure. So it's a full range of things. And they prefer to use information warfare. If they get to the point where they'll need to do attacks on critical infrastructure, they can do it.
Well, it's also fair to your question. It's cyber is the gating factor for a whole lot of new technologies and incredible growth opportunities, from IoT to autonomous cars to drones. And when you know, to me, the biggest cyber event of the fall wasn't the hacking of emails protected just by a password. It was the DDoS attack. Enabled by things, you know, the Internet of Things DDoS attack of October, there's probably a name for it.
Dyne.
Yes. That. There are players and companies that are doing a great job understanding DDoS attacks and trying to protect, but there are far too few folks who realize they need to protect themselves from it. And when you take a look at the deployment of emerging technologies, like for the last two decades, people are trying to build things that connect and that work first, and they're securing them second. And I'm not sure, as we see the possibility of the IoT, we're going to be able to secure it second, because unsecured, it creates so much power that can be attacked and abused, whether by nation states or even more frighteningly by those who aren't nation states, just a few folks who built a bot army. That whereas cyber was less of a breaker on the growth of Internet 1.0 or 2.0, I think it's the gating factor for Internet 3.0.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Question. So President Trump has said that he's promised a major report on hacking defenses within 90 days of taking office. We don't know much about it, but it seems like there will be recommendations made to federal employees and agencies. So if you were advising the president, what should he be worried about when he looks at the U.S. government defenses at this point? Any of the panelists?
The place to look is the managed services and cloud services and what emphasis they'll get. And so I think most people now recognize, you know, if you're going to use the OPM example, OPM had an IT shop of, I don't know, about 20 people. And so it was 20 people versus the People's Liberation Army, which was not like an equal contest. So one of the questions would be, do you want to get smaller federal agencies out of the business of cybersecurity? These are IT managers. They have to, you know, reset your password and all that other stuff. Cloud services, many of the cloud service providers offer better security than a small agency could do on its own. So what I'd say is look to where you can move to managed services and to cloud.
You also have the opportunity to use the government as an example, because machine learning will be the next generation of how we manage. We get so much, cybersecurity, because there's so much information that comes from the attacks that we're having to do with, there's a lot of analysis on the back end, and you never hear about the government doing a lot of analysis in their own systems, but obviously they've had some of the largest attacks. I mean, OPMs would be a very interesting one, but the idea that we move them along to machine learning and connecting these systems, and I think Jim's got a very good point that, you know, asking people to do this in an ad hoc fashion, and we don't, I mean, there really are probably, at the end of the day, we have 13 different divisions of between departments and agencies. It's manageable by, group and then in a cross-function, but we've had such a hard time figuring out how to get that cross-function right, because everybody's worried about building their own kingdom or fiefdom when it comes to this space. We just had a report that came out last week from the FCC where they think it's great that, all the carriers, including the cable companies or anybody that has an ISP, should be reporting this information just into the FCC. I'm not sure how that helps. I also, looking at the information they're asking for, it's a lot of kind of pre-decisional, anything you think might be a problem, you should send the information to us, and then I keep reading through the report and be like, what are they going to do with it? So we make sure this doesn't happen at OPM or OMB or, GSA, and there was no reference to anything other than they thought that ISPs were incapable of handling this, so they should be sending more information to the FCC. I think we need to step away from anything that's that command and control by one division.
And I think, something we're going to spend a lot of time talking about on the Hill is deconfliction between all the different agencies and even the committees of jurisdiction. And by the way,
good luck with that.
I know. I laugh too at myself when I think it. I laugh to myself.
Conflict the committees.
But look, there are some of us that are trying to at least kind of facilitate that conversation internally. I know there are a number doing so externally, and I think there has to be a realization of the dramatic seriousness of approaching this in a rational and logical way to say, what are the real challenges and threats that we face? What is the magnitude of them? And how much more important is it trying to address those for the good of not only protecting, .gov space or protecting information or even stopping to waste money and energy in a way that's inherently counterproductive versus the political realities. Now, again, political realities dominate because they are political realities, which is how most people butter their bread and think about the day. But, you know, to the point of a massive, massive utilization of weakly protected IoT devices and then all the different, you know, possible agencies and committees that could be involved in considering that versus the potential for future damage versus the fact that there's not too much of an incentive to keep, you know, or not too much of an incentive not to exfiltrate information on an ongoing clandestine basis as a foreign or sophisticated non-foreign actor. It's, you know, we're always building up to the cyber Pearl Harbor, and yet every day we have some absurdly large thing that happens that somehow is not Pearl Harbor, right? You got like billions of records getting stolen, and then 22 million, you know, we're talking fingerprints, we're talking like everything on the background of all of our clandestine officers. These are very serious things, and we can't really seem to talk about and focus on them on an ongoing basis in a way that is like, because they're abstract, they're huge numbers, they're things that we talk about and go away, but there has to be some way to sit down and think about it more logically. I know it's crazy, but maybe we can do it.
Okay. Just rattling through some issues here. So I wanted to turn to encryption, obviously an important policy issue. There's been a lot of friction between the tech industry and the national security establishment on this. Epitomized by the Apple FBI case last year. President Trump during the campaign took some shots at Apple over this issue. When you look at that Apple FBI case, do you guys consider that to be a one-time skirmish, or do you think this is more, we're going to see more of these kind of cases to come?
I see no way in which that is a one-time skirmish. And this is, it's not just going to be on the question of hard encryption of data in motion or data at rest. It's going to be on a grand spectrum of these issues. It's going to be, what about the background listening of your new Alexa? It's going to be, what about the background listening of your Samsung TV? I mean, these are cases that are already happening, and it's just going to be, and there's going to be two cases, right? There's going to be one where somebody's child was abducted and something terrible happened to them and they're trying to find their child desperately. And there's going to be another one with national security implications. And both of these are going to happen, and it's going to be a horribly irrational conversation. And that is understandable, and that is how these things always go because they're very deeply emotive things at play. But we have to do our very best as both policymakers, as people thinking about these issues, to set up a spectrum of consideration of what are the real equities at stake throughout this. So my boss, for those of you that don't know, had a bill called the Digital Security Commission Act last year designed to set up a balanced equities mechanism to discuss, you know, across digital security issues generally, but obviously encryption was a focus with Apple the FBI. Looking forward, I will have some similar mechanism, similar vehicle in terms of how that's focused to look towards emerging threats and these emerging conversations of digital security versus personal or national security that's still being discussed. But I think, again, to the greatest extent we can avoid knee-jerk, not just legislating, but knee-jerk public commentary, right? Like each of us here that writes and talks has a specific responsibility in how you relay these things to the public. So in as much as people can create space for people to not, you know, run from one tantalizing extreme to the other, I think we'll all be better off for it.
You know, it's the other love always hearing from Austin. You're 100% right, but the third scenario, which you didn't mention, but would benefit from writing about it, it's just not as sexy, are the billions of hacks that don't happen as a result of encryption protecting users. It's, and it'd be great, and I think your boss very much has been a leader in trying to make sure that the entirety of the situation is thought of in a non-urgent setting, the old urgent crowding out the important risk. And I do worry that policy and rhetoric flows from those very specific, like the show 24 life and death scenarios, as opposed to the, you know, never made the cut in Hollywood because it's not very exciting, the hacks that didn't happen because your encryption on your device or on your network worked properly. And so, you know, nobody ever read the email they weren't supposed to read or had the opportunity to take you down. But that's the vastly most common scenario, and it's one that protects all of us every day.
Maybe we should bake that in now in shows whenever they have a secret they're able to keep. Be like, good thing we didn't get hacked.
Yeah, I like that.
So I used to do this for a living. I see Mike Nelson standing in the back eating. Yeah, hide your food, Mike. When in the first crypto wars, and there were two simultaneous sets of negotiations. The first was with other countries, including not only our allies, but countries like China. And on that one, we were pretty much able to get agreement to restrict encryption, with the exception of the Germans. And the Germans now are in a somewhat different place, but they would still be the most difficult to win agreement. Everybody else in the world is ready to move. When I say everybody, I mean like G20, okay, and NATO. So that was easy. Germans don't know where they'd come out. They didn't want to restrict encryption the last time. Internally, it was next to impossible to get a deal on the Hill. I mean, so I still think that's the case. It's just, it would be really hard. But we were able to get a private deal that met the needs of intelligence and law enforcement agencies that was not public. And in looking at the cards again, looking at the players, back then you had a more, maybe it was because they'd been fighting for so long, you had a more coherent private sector position. So at the end of the day, they were all willing to go along with the deal. In looking at it, say a year ago, there's a split now among companies. Companies that would do a deal that would preserve our ability to manage encryption risk, and companies that are looking more towards the global market and worry that being seen as cozying up to Uncle Sam would be bad. And both are legitimate positions. I'm not being critical. But I think the space for a deal on encryption has gotten, the requirements for a deal on encryption have gotten a lot harder. A commission might not be a bad idea to work through some of this, but it's not going to happen this next year.
A lot to add on that, because I when you start in the beginning of the question, I always remind people that it was a passcode, not encryption, that was the case, was the issue on the Apple phone, which just shows you the different levels of, you know, issues we have here. And then to Austin's point about, you know, the encryption wars were really important for things that were, you know, worth encrypting back in the 90s, and now we're talking about, you know, somebody having an Alexa next to their bathtub during a murder scene. I mean, you know, there's just so much more interesting data out there. And I know I actually do it on myself. I look, I go back and look at my Uber records to see when all kinds of stuff happened on me. So, you know, there's a lot of information that is available. And the question is, you know, we've got to start rethinking who and why. And you know, the laws that are on the books were done back when dial tone was, you know, just a thought. So.
Sort of, I wanted to follow up on something Austin said, getting into congressional priorities for cybersecurity this year. But so the bill that you mentioned, which would create an independent commission, right, for encryption, has that been reintroduced, and what are the plans around that?
No, it hasn't yet, and we're still going to be working through some of the details of that. And I think to Shane's point, that you know, we always intended it to be as full spectrum and also future looking of a tool as possible, which is difficult because, I mean, the last year, how much has what we've discussed changed, right? So to that point, we don't want to set something up with the purpose or effect of relitigating Apple v. FBI, because that would be silly. Mm-hmm. And so that will be discussed, that will be modified. What are law enforcement's equities and concerns? And to the point of, you know, the point of industry and the privacy community and civil in general, you know, there were a lot of white papers put out, like Going Bright, talking about the incredible breadth of information that is now available that law enforcement could hypothetically use in instances where encrypted content was not available. Now, on one hand, encrypted content is often cases evidentiary as opposed to something that's used for the sake of, like, mapping out and taking somebody down. On the flip side of that, now that that door has been opened and discussed, which I actually appreciate that it was opened and discussed publicly, because you don't want to find out a year later that your stuff's all spying on you and then have to, like, chase every corporation out of town and we can never be, you know, Silicon Valley again. Mm-hmm. You know, I think that that's a real conversation we're going to have a very transparent conversation about, to some extent. Like, obviously not entirely transparent, but the more that consumers can have confidence that these emerging and, you know, highly successful and still based in America products are meeting their criteria for privacy and for security, the more that they're going to adopt them and pick them up. However, If we don't, then there's going to be massive outcry later when it's found out that, hey, you gave all this information to third parties trusting that it's going to be safe, and turns out it wasn't. So I think that is going to be a big conversation, and again, the more we can get out ahead of it, the better off we'll be. On the flip side of that, you know, there's a lot of, at least even in Homeland Security, a lot of stuff to keep talking about, keep working on cyber legislation-wise. We've still got to do some reorganizational legislation. We're still taking a look at cyber insurance. And we still have to oversee the ongoing implementation of the Cybersecurity Act. We're still in the very nascent stages of cyber information sharing as per the statutory authority in that act. And it's going to be a not insignificant process to oversee it. And I'm sure that that is a small slice of all the different things other folks with other jurisdictional hooks could enjoy talking about.
Mm-hmm. But I think one of the knock-on effects to this previous conversation is with information sharing and the challenge of companies who don't feel like they've gotten the level of indemnification to be in the information sharing pool. So where we have, like, the financial industries, the financial services industry, who has very specific guidance as to what they can and can't share amongst themselves, do very well with their information sharing, their financial services ISOC. We've tried to emulate that in other industries, and if you talk to the individual industry partners, they say they don't, their lawyers really just say, do you really want to share that? They don't. There's not a level of trust yet that this is being shared purely for the idea of malware and code and trying to find, you know, the zero-day attack type information, because they don't have that level of trust within the government that something isn't eventually going to come back and be a challenge for the corporation or the industry partner.
Sticking with Congress for a minute, the giant Yahoo data breach has sort of brought the issue of data breach notification back to some extent. We've seen a number of bills in previous years around that. What do the panelists think about data breach notification? Is that an issue that might come back in this new Congress?
Can we start with a poll? How many people in the room still use Yahoo as their primary email account? What, Mike? Oh, are you kidding me?
Mike. Who still uses their AOL account? That's like always a dividing
shame,
factor.
Raise your hands. I know there's some AOL users out there. Yeah, respect.
Right. You don't want to get rid of that.
You can paint on the roof of your cave too. You know,
it's if like, there were members of members of Congress, there would be like 15 to 20 hands up, and a bunch of others would be lying. Yeah.
Right. What was the question? I forget.
You hijacked my question. No, it was about data breach notification.
Just curious. Yeah.
Data breach notification bills. Is that still important? Is that going to come back?
I think it's inevitable. I mean, I know I was around the, you know, we were doing this 10, 12, 15 years ago, and the states had a way that they wanted to manage it, and it felt manageable back then. I think the fact that so much information has gotten out there, and we don't have a very streamlined a way of managing it going forward, is just going to become a constituent issue for members, which is going to drive it into legislation.
Well, and the key word there being states, you know, what is clearly intolerable and ineffective is having 50 different approaches to data breach notification in the United States alone. You know, and then you take a look at the questions of cross-border data flow, forced localization, data sovereignty around the world, and we're going to clearly need a harmonized American approach so that we don't get bullied around by the rest of the world into either being required to break the cloud down into 175 different clouds in every country, or otherwise losing so much of the aggregation capabilities that happen when you have single standards.
The one objection I've heard, and it's actually from someone in the room, he can raise his hand if he wants. The objection is that when you take the state rules are all at differing levels of protection, and so the natural negotiating process will be to move from a best case
to California
to somewhere, right, somewhere a bit different. And so that's probably a legitimate fear. I don't know if it's avoidable, though. Are you raising your hand? Yeah, hi, Greg. So Greg Nojime, CDT. See him afterwards if you want to know. It's a legitimate concern, right, that in any negotiating process, things might not come out the way you want.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Sticking with congressional issues, What do you think of, there's been other pieces of proposed legislation floating around in the past year. One is ECPA in terms of privacy, and 702 surveillance reform that Congress is going to have to deal with that presumably later this year. What do you see as the prospects for anything passing in those areas?
I'll take a quick bet. I think we should change the name to like ectoplasm or something.
Yeah.
how many years have we been hearing about ECPA reform? Who knows, maybe this year it will happen. Next year in Washington. 702, there will be one dark night and you'll wake up and it'll have been reauthorized. So ECPA, don't know, don't track 702. The problem is in the previous administration is a good example. A senator comes into the White House, he's suspicious of surveillance. 3 months later, suddenly he decides it's a good idea. What you need to do when you're president means that you need to have surveillance tools, and 702 is crucial.
Do you think, just to clarify, do you think it will be reauthorized with no changes or with some changes?
Maybe some cosmetic changes if they need to, like we could reverse the numbers or something.
I actually, to that point, I do think if is it going to be a very difficult equation for a lot of people in the civil community and the privacy community as these bills come up, or maybe not. Maybe it'll be super simple, and they'll just say the only proposal is straight reauth, so we all hate it. I mean, who could say? Yeah. But I think that if there are changes that you can see, I mean, try to put yourself into the headspace of the people that are going to be making these fundamental changes. Say, what are the scalpel changes that we would like to get? Now, here's the flip side of that. Mm-hmm. If you get your changes, you're probably going to say you like it, in which case, I'm not sure who's going to do that either. So I think that the more that you can try to be realistic about the circumstances and try to approach this in a way to get the best gettable good, which I know is anathema to a lot of folks in that space, that might be something that you could actually get some type of reforms. Otherwise, it's just going to be loggerheads and it's going to be an ultimate crash. ECPA, you know, as long as Senator Cornyn and others want the Ector fix, it's always going to be something. It's like 21st century cures and some childhood cancer provisions my boss was working on. You know, as long as there's one large thing that other people want, it's very difficult to get those everybody agrees things to happen. It's hard to say, but unfortunately a bit bearish.
Okay.
I don't know what a 702 reform would look like. Would it involve notifying other people? But the word I always use with other countries is I'm all for it. How about some reciprocity? Usually that's the end of the conversation. So I understand Europeans are unhappy that maybe the U.S. spies on them. I have reason to believe they spy on us. And so when you say, how about some reciprocity, that's usually the end of the conversation. So I don't, maybe you know.
No, well, only you're handicapping. I don't bet, but if I were going to bet, I would bet it will absolutely be reauthorized with no changes. And the only difference between Jim's prognosis and mine is I don't think it'll be dead of dark night. I think it'll be broad daylight and the old knock the battery off my shoulder. You be against surveillance, maintaining surveillance capabilities in this scary world.
I'm going to concur on that one.
Okay. So going back to Russia for a minute, Jim.
Yep.
The sanctions that were imposed on Russia in relation to the hacking of the election. Do you think that those will stay in place under President Trump? What is the debate there?
Anyone who wants to answer that in the audience, feel free to.
No.
Don't know. I mean, the one thing we've learned from the last decade is that if there are no consequences for malicious actions, people will continue to do them. And you can use consequences to reshape opponent behavior. So maybe these aren't the right consequences. Maybe this is an incident that's in the past. But we will need to develop a quicker way to say, here's a proportional response that has an effect on what opponents think.
I might add two thoughts. First, I mean, it's very clear, not only the campaign, but taking office and confirmation hearing rhetoric, the new administration takes cyber very seriously, and it's a top priority. I can't tell you where they'll end up, but I can tell you it's not is not an afterthought in any way, shape, or form. I would not be shocked to see an effort made over the next 2 to 3 years for a multilateral trade deal around cyber, which, you know, the historic approach to trade deals are obviously being revisited and rethought as recently as this morning. As best I can read the everything's breaking news in CNN, but the CNN breaking news alerts. breaking news is broken on CNN. At the same time, I could see them trying to rally a lot of countries together, and you think, you know, whether it's our desire to have no cross-border data flow barriers or the ability to have the type of global surveillance necessary or opposition to efforts, industrial espionage now performed digitally you know, at least what you read in the paper. I wasn't at Davos, but the president of China's sudden finding of globalization and multilateralism, I think there is a real opportunity and a lot of positive policy that could be advanced. And the trick is their ability to keep the desire and needs for militaries to have offensive capability, not necessarily use, but offensive capability, out of the negotiation.
I wanted to ask about one incident that's gotten sort of overshadowed by the Russia hacking was the North Korea Sony hack a few years ago. Now that we've had a chance to look at that and study that and look at the implications of that, what do you think? Do you think the government learned any lessons from that, and do any of those lessons apply going forward?
I think it's always a great example of the challenge that we have that goes into the, you know, Russia's a little more defined. So you have North Korea and the Japanese, who have a long-term hatred towards each other, that, you know, if the North Koreans supposedly did this, you know, they damaged a Japanese company who for 10 days decided not to put out a movie. And the president of the United States said he wished the CEO of the Japanese company would have called him. I have no idea what that conversation would have been about. I mean, just because we don't have many things in place, it's an asymmetrical response to a very awkward situation. And I was talking about this at lunch, that Wired magazine did a great piece about the after effects a year later and how much damage was done to Sony internally. But that was actually a really good case, corner case lesson on how not to set up your IT department in a huge, you know, conglomerate, because they should not have been able to do that much damage. Those systems probably shouldn't have been connected the way they were. But from a perspective of what should the government have done at that point, I don't think we have the pieces in place, and I don't think we've yet to discover how to best respond to that, which is, you know, going into the Russian situation of making sure that we actually have the ability to know who did it, when, and then what is an appropriate response.
So there used to be a British cartoon, and I remember a line from it, which was, I thought he was going to punch me, so I punched him back first. That might be a good rule here, right? And so the idea that I'm a little less dubious about involvement here, and so it was clearly the North Koreans, it was clearly an effort of political coercion. There are similarities to what they did, to what Iran did to Aramco. And you had a group of countries, Russia, Iran, North Korea, discovered that you could use cyberspace for coercive political purposes. It's not an attack, so it's not war and all that other garbage. But it's clearly something that violates the political integrity and independence of the country. And we need to think, so my arms control friends say, and so please forgive me, I know you're all geeks, we need to populate all the rungs of the escalation ladder. Oh, I love saying that. What does that mean? It means we need to develop things from little responses to big responses, but we need to develop responses. So I think creating consequences for places like North Korea and Iran would be a good thing.
That sort of leads to another question, which is, you know, I remember at the time of the Russia, when the Russia sanctions were imposed, Vice President Biden gave an interview, and I'm just going to paraphrase him here, but he basically said, you know, some things you'll know, some things you won't know about how we respond. Presumably the things we know about are the sanctions, but what are the effective options for the U.S. to use in cases like North Korea or cases like Russia or other, you know, situations of interference in some way.
This was a hilarious set of discussions. And so they went through, they were actually set to impose the sanctions in August and then delayed for a whole set of reasons. But they also went through a range of other options. And one, I'm not making this up, maybe people have heard it before, but one of the options was, well, how about if we leak Vladimir Putin's Botox injection schedule? I thought, Jesus, pardon me, goodness gracious, is that really the best we can do? And so the question is not, again, not, you know, we're going to turn off the electrical power, we're going to have a dam blow up, or we're going to do something that could be lead to escalation or further violence. The question is, what damaging information do we want to release on the Russians? And one of the guideposts there is we know that the Panama Papers leak drove them wild. And we know that the penalties for their constant drug use in international sports drove them wild. So there's two targets right there. That might be a good place to think about.
That's kind of the, yeah, I mean, correct. That's kind of one of the bizarre parts of the current world that we find ourselves in that is so interesting about deriving some type of federal response. I mean, you're talking about, you know, a private entity in a different country that was attacked by a foreign actor for the purposes of, you know, again, like a largely a perceived personal slight, you know, which is why it's funny that we would have a personal slight response of releasing his Botox schedule, perhaps, which is, mm-hmm. I actually did not hear that and find that to be hilarious.
That's why he looks so stern all the time. He can't move his.
And so, you know, I mean, these are the, you know, and we're talking about, like, okay, they didn't like the doping news or the doping response to their Olympic team and other things like that. So, I mean, we're going to get into this bizarre, you know, macro social tit for tat game where we're trying to figure out, like, what's going to make them feel as bad as several billion dollars felt to Sony and then its nexus to our activity. And again, these are questions that are have wide reaching consequences, because we're going to have to, again, I mean, we're the first real generation of this world that we're living in its like maximized, actualized form, right? So we're gonna have to figure out what these rules look like as we're porting massive chunks of the physical world into digital space and then remove a lot of the international barriers, right? It's not difficult for the Russian underground to go knock against everybody's like possible vulnerability, figure out which one they can put something into and then get something back out. And obviously every sophisticated nation on earth has a similar thing going on at the moment where they are also exfiltrating and doing all these similar activities to whatever extent their legal frameworks may or may not allow. So, you know, how do we establish what that allowable universe looks like? I don't know, Jim, you've done some work on this. What do you think?
Yeah, we're just, some of it's lack of experience, yeah. And so we're just going to have to fumble our way around for a while. Sanctions weren't a bad idea. A lot of countries thought it was a good thing to do. But we're going to need to experiment.
Well, I would, agreeing with what Austin said. I mean, this the idea that what he uses Botox and the, you know, particularly these days, if it's going to be a back and forth. I mean, TMZ is the new DMZ.
Yeah, right.
That's depressing.
Did you write that yourself, or did you?
I know it writes itself.
Wow. Okay.
That was good.
Shane, did you have anything?
Now I have this.
I'm out of here.
Now I'm thinking we should use the Kardashians as a, you know, weapon of mass destruction, because that would just like add to the TMZ schedule to like a whole nother level.
Seriously, we're like really close to devolving off into absurdity, which is both, again, hilarious, but also deeply disconcerting on a certain level. So, you know, anybody with great suggestions, anybody with a laid out plan of attack, why don't you just give us all a call? We'd love to talk about it.
Well, look for things that bother them and then figure out how you can amplify them. I mean, it's not going to be attacking the power grid, but there are things we know that bother them. Do more.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I think I'm just going to ask one more question, sort of forward looking, and then I think we have some time for some audience questions if anybody has any. So crystal ball time, if we're looking ahead to this year, what do you all think that will be the major cyber threats or cybersecurity issues this year?
I think one of the things that you're going to see this administration tackle, because the Russian situation has put cyber front and center, is that we have to get two parts of the House in order. One is our own government, which is it's got its own challenges. And the second tier is how do we engage the private sector community, the commercial users, who really they're holding statistics vary, 89% to 95% of the actual equipment, and how do you encourage them to manage that forward without having that be a regulation? Because we don't want to create a floor while we think that we're creating a ceiling on how to manage this. So I think that there's going to be a lot of thought process into that. I don't know that that's going to be a huge public discussion, but I think that's where you're going to see a lot of your cyber expertise this year.
I might focus on three that I either expect or hope for. First, we're collectively still not very good at basic blocking and tackling, neither government nor private sector. And again, as mentioned, with the Russian election hack, it started because of lack of multi-factor authentication. It's 80% of the problems that we face, we could probably resolve merely by having folks understand and be a little bit more accountable, your point in Sony, for how we protect data and information. Maybe that'll be driven on the Hill, maybe that'll be driven in the courts, but I think blocking and tackling is one. I think there will be a greater emphasis on the need to bake in cyber into IoT, into autonomous cars, and into emerging technologies in a way that for the last 30 years, emerging technologies haven't had to think about cyber first, and I think they will. And the last, I hope and expect we're gonna have recognition how important white hat hacking and the need to make sure we're able to defend ourselves, and so things like Wassenaar or DMCA 1201, that we shouldn't have terms of use prevent people from finding vulnerabilities and only become aware of vulnerabilities once everybody has been hacked. There are ways to encourage and to support our white hat friends, and I think we're going to need to do it, and I think policy has a role to play there too.
I'm sort of the inside baseball thing. One of the things the new administration is looking at is what should the role of DoD be, and particularly what should the role of DoD be for protecting critical infrastructure. And I understand that the Joint Chiefs of Staff are doing a report on this. I think this is speculation. Where they'll come out is that DoD needs to think about major crises and how they provide assistance and all that. This is an issue that goes back really years. Should we give NSA a bigger role in defending cyberspace? And the answer is always no, right? We had a little group that discussed this topic, and there were a few people in the group, all of whom came out of DOD, was like, yeah, it's a great idea, let's have DOD. The whole entire rest of, and certainly all the big companies said, no, we don't want DOD. Now, the flip side of that is if you're not going to have DOD doing this, because advanced capabilities, you need to make DHS stronger. And there's been a good job in the last decade or more in building DHS up, but the general sense is it's not there yet, and we have to change that.
Yeah, I mean, I would agree with that. That is going to mean for obvious reasons. But even beyond that, I think there is a critical importance to maintain the separation between a civilian and a military responsibility when it comes to cybersecurity, because, again, the further that you, to the point of surveillance reform, talking about 702 before, perception is reality when you can't go read classified briefings. And even for a lot of people on the Hill that are on the more critical side of the issue that go read those classified briefings, they're still, they may not necessarily think that they're getting the entirety of the information. So, if as long as that keeps getting portrayed to people and you have these increasingly growing bodies of folks that are reading your alternative, different sources of information about what could be going on with surveillance. I think that the more that you can be, again, there's obviously a need for secrecy, there's obviously a need for data, for like the protection of information, but the more that you can be transparent about the different responsibilities of the civilian and the military space, the more that you can be upfront about, coherent about what is encryption good to do for people and where are people concerned about it and where those equities really lie, so you don't get into these false dichotomies of something good, something bad. The better off we're gonna be, not only as it pertains to figuring out what different sections of the government should be doing and unifying those voices. But on the flip side of that, not screwing up a rapidly growing dynamic sector of the economy and not losing our ability to have these companies headquartered here. Because you know, every time somebody decides to go and diverge from the standing practice of, all right, we're going to protect encryption and protect data, and we want to prevent the balkanization of the internet, and we want to do, you know, all of these things, a different company decides to move to a place in the Netherlands. And, you know, I mean, you end up having these very natural, obvious effects, and it's only going to get worse from here as more and more data is either directly or indirectly in the hands of third parties and then perhaps the federal government. So I think keeping that separate is going to be hugely important. I think beyond that, it is going to be doing a lot of the nuts and bolts of cyber policy, a lot of figuring out who has responsibility where, who's doing a good job, and who needs to do more and who needs to do less. And to Jim's point, it is of absolute necessity that we build up, figure out whatever needs to be done, whether it's in terms of talent development and luring in talent from other places or flexible pay scales or whatever it may be, to build up the capability of DHS so that we can effectively count on them to carry out their mission as effectively as reasonably possible.
And just your boss has been in favor of doing some consolidation of congressional oversight of DHS and building up its cyber capabilities, right? So what's happening on that front, or what are the goals this year?
So we do have a memorandum of understanding between all the major committees of jurisdiction to fully reauthorize DHS. In terms of what that means for consolidating operational oversight, you know, it's standing on the reauthorization point for the time being. But I think that there is, at least a understanding and willingness to continue to work together on that front. But you know, it's not a major jurisdictional change by any means. But I think that you will see, first of all, I think you will see different entities, different agencies, different committees try to lay claim to cybersecurity and try to show that they understand it, that they can do the best with it. And I think you'll also see more and more bodies rising up and saying, look, we all have a different set of equities and a different perspective on, you know, our piece of the cybersecurity pie. So how do we bring those together for the grander mission of not globally and royally screwing it up? Okay. But that's my hopeless and deathless optimism.
Okay. I think we may have time for one or two questions. There may be a microphone floating around. I'm not sure. Actually, there it is right there.
Two.
Oh, two. Okay.
Hey, how are you? Sunny Sinha, I'm the person with the AOL account because his first girlfriend's emails are still there. I'm proud of that, actually. AOL got us here. But more importantly, and thank you all for putting on a great panel. This has been a fantastic discussion. My background is I work with the chairman. McCaul. We're in the Obama administration around CISA and a number of other issues. And particularly encryption came up at that time. So my question is, around the encryption issue, there are two things. One is that, you know, the innovation curve supports greater encryption because you're going to have peer-to-peer technologies and all these other modalities kind of moving forward that would support the need for an encryption without a backdoor. The second is that in our previous modus of operandi, you know, if the FBI or a law enforcement agency had some type of terror case in which they needed some type of access to information, they actually had the mechanisms in which to subpoena, you know, and find out what that information was from the provider. And often those things happening under goodwill, you know, and you know, who's going to hold that information back if a tragedy happens? And given those two dynamics, what is the need to actually address the encryption issue urgently?
I mean, I don't actually think that there is an urgent need to address encryption or strong encryption as a general matter. I mean, I think that it is a smaller piece of a much larger consideration. And there are obvious incentives first of all, some business models and some methods of setting up a technology remove the company from the equation just as a matter of like maximum efficiency, and others remove them as a matter of maximum legal efficiency. So in all circumstances, I think that at least for me personally, I don't want to be telling a company how to set up. You know, I don't want to be going to a CTO saying, like, look, this is the most secure way to set it up, but you make it dumber for me. You know, I mean, that's definitely not a circumstance I want to find myself in. But I don't, I think that it's the larger question that is of greater urgency, and I think the reason that my boss's Digital Security Commission was cast as the Crypto Commission was because that was the main headline-grabbing topic. I mean, even in the text of the legislation, even in our messaging around it, we were attempted to be careful to not cast it as that, but that was outside of our power to prevent. But yeah, I don't believe so. I think that it's highly probable that there will be some event that causes it to come back, because there are always going to be people annoyed that the old methods of doing things in terms of, you know, law enforcement or counterterrorism aren't going to suffice. But at the same time, you have to keep in mind, for those people, I mean, you know, I can't tell you how many times I've been down to our district talking to people that are in those forensic centers. They're like, look, this, I understand what you're saying. I understand that this is going to be bad from an economic perspective, that it's technologically unwise, but I have 17 terabytes of the most disgusting stuff you've seen in your entire life, and I'm trying to, like, destroy this animal that's been killed. You know, I mean, it's like the visceral response of people that have to look at this stuff and deal with this stuff all the time is real, and it's intense. And I think that was the best thing for me to understand, is that it is, you know, there's an article recently about the people that have to, you know, work filtration or like crisis response for child issues for some internet service providers, and the PTSD that they have, and them filing back suit. Like, this is the darkest side of humanity, and these people are trying to put them away and stop them from hurting other kids and, like, continuing this cycle of pain and destruction, right? So, very clear equities, and it's very difficult for both sides to see them, and that was kind of the idea of the commission, was to say, to the point of filter bubbles, like, our filter bubbles are getting stronger, they ain't getting weaker, you know what I mean? So if you're in that circle of technologists, you're not gonna really consider the other side of what those people are going through. And if you're in that circle of, you know, law enforcement professionals or counterterrorism professionals, you know, you're not gonna care about what some egghead off in whatever land is telling you about, because you got people to save and bad guys to catch. You know, but I think the more that you can say, like, look, here are our very legitimate and real concerns and issues, and the flip side can say the same, and there can be at least some mutual understanding, you can get to a less unreasonable path forward, where it's not just one side barreling over another, depending on the pendulum of power, right?
Thank you.
Circuitous, but hopefully it helps.
And then real quickly, Dr. Lewis, given your national security background, would you think that FBI, law enforcement, and those folks have all the tools they need to be able to keep up kind of with the digital frontiers and fights that are going on?
So if you'd asked me 4 or 5 months ago, I would have told you that FBI might be coming out with more data to show that they don't have the tools. And it's a declining curve, and how fast it's declining is up to, you know, it's sort of open to question. But I would say right now they don't have the tools. We're just lucky, the same way we were lucky before, and most people don't use this stuff. And so as long as that continues to be the case, but as that changes and as it becomes easier to use apps, it's funny if you look. So you can. There's good data on child pornography that shows before the internet, steady decline. After the internet, steady increase. Right? Okay. This thing has been a pain since day one. We're in decline, and the question is, when does it become intolerable? It may never become intolerable. So right now, they collect less. It's not the end of the world. That's where we are.
I don't know if we have time for one more question. Okay, one more question.
Hi, Greg Noge. I'm from Center for Democracy and Technology. I wouldn't be quite so dismissive about reforms of Section 702. Reason is there's going to be some pressure from Europe, where challenges to the privacy shield have already started, and they largely turn on the access that the government has under Section 702. So there's going to be some pressure coming from Europe. And there's also a number of common sense reforms that at least a group of us have been talking about that I think will get more attention later. One is, for example, in this targeted program, to make it so that the target actually has to be a party to the communications being intercepted. That's not currently a requirement. Another reform is to make it so that this program, defended mostly on terrorism grounds, is actually limited to real particular national security issues like terrorism, WMD proliferation, and the like. And another reform is the one that passed the House twice when attached to appropriations bills, which is to close what we call the backdoor search loophole which is what allows the government to search this data collected by targeting foreigners for information about Americans. So I'd just like you to think again, maybe a little more broadly, about whether reforms are possible to Section 702, rather than just kind of dismiss it based on the general atmosphere that we're going in through right now.
Well, and I'll be the first to say, I would prefer not to dismiss them. And I think that the more that we can critically use any of these points to like make a rational determination of all of these factors and figure out the best way forward, we'll be better off. I think it's more of a reading of the current circumstances. Who knows what could change in the very near future, A, and B, you know, if people can rally behind, you know, a consolidated strategy to achieve those reforms. And I also think that we're in a volatile public environment right now, transparently. And so, you know, who's to say what could happen that could shift to some extent both public and Congress, but I think the future is going to belong to both the nimble and the prepared and willing to be a bit dynamic.
There's a couple weird things that shape this discussion. We looked at 702 and we realized that don't reauthorize 702. Don't bother. And then we'll default to EO12333. Guess what? A lot more freedom under EO12333. So go ahead. Don't renew it. We won't be worse off. Second thing that's weird is you have this split in Europe. It's really irritating. So the European Commission is the one doing Privacy Shield and all this and saying the U.S. must reform 702. And then when you say to them, okay, guys, let's be reciprocal. There's that word again. They say, oh, we don't do intelligence. That's the member state. So we can't possibly come to, we want you to give something up, but we can't give anything back. And so it's kind of weird. The third part is, I think I come back to this, presidents find that they have a responsibility for protecting the nation and that this is a crucial tool for it. So you'll see it reauthorized in some way, but when I look at the political dynamics, the easiest path, and I don't know what you guys think, the easiest path is just reauthorize it without going into a big debate. I still think it would happen in the middle of the night.
Well, I think we're out of time, but I want to thank my panelists, Austin, Jim, Bruce, and Shane. Thank you very much, everyone.